أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل أعوذ برب الناس ملك الناس إله الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين. The intention this evening is to try and complete the dars of Surat An Nas, but before I do, there is some leftover subject matter from Surat Al Falaq that should be addressed, and I purposely omitted it originally, but after some discussion I had with someone after the dars, I realized this is a point of confusion for a lot of people, and it probably should be at least given some consideration, some mention. What I'm talking about is two things, inshallah ta'ala, two influences that have swept the Muslim ummah in our time and has influenced the understanding of a wide number of people. What used to be considered a minute minority, a side thing, almost a faction, has almost become mainstream, and it's actually quite problematic. The first of those things is a result of what we call scientific rationalism. And scientific rationalism essentially is the attempt of someone to look at the sacred literature and to constantly to try to correlate it with rationale, with science, specifically with science. And if you go overboard in this direction, you can make mistakes like those of the late Sir Sayyid Ahmed Khan, who's a great political leader for the Muslims in India, yet when it came to his interpretation of the Quran, he made some monumental mistakes. For instance, he said, jinn, Allah says he created them for fire, but that's all figurative. It just means that these are people that are really fired up. It's not really a different creature. It's just people that get really angry are called jinn. And, you know, angels are made of light, and light just refers to people, you know, people that are full of guidance, and they are a source of goodness for others, etc. So angels are really good people, and jinn are really bad people. And heaven and hell are just states of mind, etc., etc. To try to reinterpret the religion in a way that would be more plausible for someone who's overly impressed with science, or at least getting to reality through the five senses. And in this regard, the reason I brought this up now instead of any other time is when we were talking about Surat Al-Falaq, we were talking about the evils that may exist in the nighttime. And I did want to make a clarification. Night in and of itself is not evil. The creation of night is not evil, but it can have evil in it. And there's potential for evil in it. The creature itself, the creation of night itself, may or may not be harmful. But does it have the potential in it? Yes. There are nights that are wonderful. For example, Allah talks about Laylatun Mubarakah. Inna anzalnahu fi Laylatil Qadr. Wa idh wa'adna Musa 40 laylatan thumma takhattum al-ajr. You know, messengers were called at night, revelation came down in the night of power. You know, Subhana alladhi asra bi abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa. The messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on the journey of Isra and Mi'raj in the nighttime. By the way, because of scientific rationalism, more and more people are convinced, no, he didn't really travel. This was just a dream that he had, and etc., etc. Right? Now, that's one problem, to try to give scientific rationale a higher place than actual revelation itself. But a byproduct of this movement has become that we've been influenced a lot more by Western criticism of Islamic sacred literature, specifically Hadith literature. And if you know, I'm not going to get into Orientalism with you generally, but I'll tell you something over an overview. And the overview is that in Western academics, non-Muslim academics on Islam, the first point of attack is Hadith. The first line of attack is against Hadith. And actually they reverse engineer the study of Hadith. And let me tell you what that means. They actually study it. The first claim they'll make is, you know, we don't really see Hadith being compiled at least like 100 to 150 years after the Prophet's passing, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's, you know, it's already historically questionable. Then on top of that, the more authentic a Hadith is, like if it's muttafaqun alayh, it's agreed upon, or it's from Muslim and Bukhari, and it comes from several narrators, etc., there's tawatur in it, etc., they'll say the more authentic it is actually a bigger cover-up by those who made it up. So the more authentic it is, actually, that's how much more fabricated it is. And this is actually taught in universities, from this point of view, it's taught in universities. Now, this hadith skepticism is not something that's only taken up by non-Muslims. Actually, Muslims have also fallen victim to this kind of work. And a lot of times, actually, they become very adamant about it and feel like if you are going to interpret the Qur'an using incidents in the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, what we call asbabun nuzul, context of revelation. In Surah Al-Falaq, we talked about how there were attempts made to cast a spell upon the Messenger ﷺ. That's part of asbabun nuzul. That's not mentioned explicitly in the Qur'an, but this occurs in several hadith narrations. Now, when you resort to those narrations, they say, you know what you're doing here? You're resorting to these made-up hadith that, you know, we shouldn't really interpret the Qur'an using those texts. Qur'an should only be interpreted on its own virtue. This is an oversimplification of the matter. And I'm not going to give you a defense of hadith literature in this session. That's not the subject today at all. But I will tell you some fundamental things that we have to keep in mind. People who say that, you know, the Qur'an is critical, but the hadith literature is not, it can't even be trusted. There are several very basic issues with it, even without getting any deeper. The Qur'an is transmitted to us by means of the companions of Allah's Messenger, radiallahu anhu ajma'in. The entire body of hadith literature is transmitted to us by what means? The same sahaba. If you say they can't be trusted with hadith, then by extension, you are also saying they can't be trusted with Qur'an. Also, when you're saying that the Qur'an does not have contradictions, because anybody who says, I believe in Qur'an, but I don't take the Sunnah seriously, or Hadith seriously, I'm just going to rely on the Qur'an, then they also come with the claim that the Qur'an does not have contradictions. It can't. But if you don't turn to the Sunnah, you'll be very confused, because the Qur'an will say, فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. Even between, if between you and the other there is animosity, treat him like your most intimate friend. In a passage talking about da'wah and the ethics of da'wah, Allah says, even if the person is showing you animosity, treat him like an intimate friend. But then you read another passage in the Quran and Allah says, وَاقْتُلُوهُمْ حَيْثُ ثَقِفْتُمُوهُمْ وَأَخْرِجُوهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ أَخْرَجُوكُمْ وَالْفِتْنَةُ أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْقَتْلِ. Kill them wherever you find them. Expel them from where they expelled you. And the trial and tribulation and corruption they're causing is worse than the fighting. If you think fighting is bad, what they're doing is even worse. So on the other hand, you're supposed to treat them like your best friend. On the other hand, you're engaged in fighting. Seems like a contradiction, unless you understand the context of this ayah and the context of that ayah. And the Qur'an will not tell you the context. The first ayah of a surah isn't هَذِهِ سُورَةٌ مَكِّيَّةٌ or هَذِهِ سُورَةٌ مَدَنِيَّةٌ. This is a Madani surah, this is a Makki surah, this was revealed at this time. So understand it in this context, and that was revealed at that time, so you understand it that does not happen in the Qur'an. Context comes essentially and primarily from hadith literature, from the seerah literature. So this oversimplification can lead to many, many, many problems. Now I'm not going to get also into the psychology. Why would somebody be so adamantly against hadith literature? What's the, you know, it's the irony of it all is that the people who are adamant about this stuff, they actually declare themselves champion of the Qur'an and the only voices of genuine Islamic understanding, and everybody else is pushing a deviant, corrupted understanding of Islam. So they actually portray themselves as heroes of the religion that are taking these courageous steps against these horrible traditional scholars. And they literally, the conversation I had last week with a brother had very foul things to say about even Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah. And I couldn't believe my ears. I knew this stuff existed, but it's become more and more popularized. Of course, also because of the spread of the web and things like that. Inshallah ta'ala, when the time comes, I will be doing a series on just a respect, not even the authenticity of the sunnah, just respect for the sunnah, just that. Before we talk about its authenticity, how much importance and regard does it have just from the Qur'an itself? We're not even going to go to a hadith for that. But we'll do a series on that separately, inshallah ta'ala. But that's one point I wanted to bring to your attention before we continue. And I don't want you to be, at least one logical claim I'll bring to you that has been brought up about Surah Al-Falaq. They say that if the Prophet ﷺ was cast a spell on and he would forget things that he did or think that he did something and he hadn't actually done it, which is found in Sahih narrations, then you are legitimizing the claims of those who say that he is influenced by magic or he's a magician. Now this again is, if you look at the claim very deeply, that's not really a solid claim, because the claim that he's a magician means he's the one who does the magic. And here the claim isn't that he's doing magic, that the claim is that he's being influenced by magic. The second claim that is made is, if you say that he was influenced by magic, you are saying there's no power except Allah, that there is a power except other than Allah, which is that of magic itself. Well, the second issue here is, you know, power, Allah Azza wa Jalla has given certain creations power too. Allah has given creations power. Human beings have some power. You know, jinns have some power. We have some power. But in the end, that the source of that power is Allah Azza wa Jalla. And there's no greater power than Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So the fact that something can have effect, like it's a, you know, to say, for example, fire burns, you say, no, you fire doesn't burn, Allah burns it. Well, fire does burn it, but Allah gave it the ability to burn. Right? Allah gave it that power. And Allah can seize that power and put it on hold and refuse to burn when Ibrahim is thrown in it. That's the power of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. No, you could say, for example, somebody was killed by a gunshot, right? How could you say that? No, death only comes when Allah's command comes. The bullet didn't kill him. This is silly now. Yes, the bullet killed him, but it could only have killed him by the amr of Allah, but if Allah gave it permission. So magic can influence someone. It can harm someone, just like a bacteria or a virus can. You know, to us, it's in the unseen, just like to the old timers of other civilizations. You know, these microscopic creatures, which literally are unseen to us, but they are seen under a microscope. When they would be suffered by these things, they would say we're possessed by demons and things like that. Right? But these things have an effect and you have a cure. Similarly, this issue of people doing magic and it having some impact, this is something Allah talks about himself in Surah Al-Baqarah. يُعَلِّمُونَ النَّاسَ السِّحْرِ. You know, Allah sent angels at Babel, Harut and Marut, and they were teaching people magic as a trial. And they would teach someone magic, they would say, look, if you're going to learn it, if you learn it, then it's going to be considered kufr and you will go to hellfire. فَلَا تَكْفُرْ. So they would say, إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ فِتْنَةٌ فَلَا تَكْفُرْ. Somebody comes to learn magic from them, they say, look, we're just here to test you. We'll teach you if you want to, but if you do, know that it's kufr. Don't do kufr. We're letting you know ahead of time. This is going to land you in big trouble. فَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مِنْهُمَا. They learn from them. مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ. What would cause partition between the husband and the wife? So they would learn magic that would cast spells and create rift between husband and wife. They learned these things. And Allah acknowledges that in the Quran itself. But then he says, وَمَا هُمْ بِضَارِّينَ بِهِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. They would never be able to harm anyone except if Allah would give the permission. So even this idea, if you legitimize magic, then you're saying that Allah doesn't have all the power. Even that is an oversimplification and an inaccurate depiction of the Quran's message. But all of these things are done because one is over-influenced with logical, rational thought or scientific rationalism, right? And these things start influencing their judgment on the Quran itself.